In the early 80s, Formula One and supercars were beyond the budget of most wannabe racing drivers. The best he could afford was a dadmobile like this classic boxy Cortina. But the Cortina would never cut it as a race machine. It was all down to aerodynamics.
So this very Cortina was the last to roll off the production line in 1982. It was the end of an era for a car which sadly had the aerodynamics of a brick.
Behind closed doors, Ford of Britain was working on a redesign that would change the appearance of its cars forever. After the oil crises of the 70s, Ford designers started working on a car that would be more economical than the Cortina. And their key to improved fuel efficiency was the aerodynamics. In 1982, the Cortina's replacement was unveiled, the Ford Sierra. The new streamlined design was an impressive 20% more aerodynamically efficient than the Cortina. It was an important step forward for road cars, but it was what happened next that turned the Sierra into an unlikely British icon. This man, Rod Mansfield, who headed up Ford's special vehicle engineering team, was told to turn it into a race car.
So Rod, why did you take a basic family saloon car and turn it into a racing car?
This car was aimed at racing and winning the World Touring Car Challenge.
But before they could go racing, if they wanted any chance of winning, Rod and his team had to massively improve the performance of the basic, rather pedestrian Sierra.
So we had to build onto this car here all the things that motorsport wanted.
Did you think retrospectively that this car that you and your department had produced would become so synonymous with the 1980s?
No, it's become an icon, and I must admit it surprised me.
Ford called in Formula One engine experts Cosworth to sort out the standard Sierra's rather weedy 75 horsepower Pinto block. They added a new cylinder head and another favorite bit of F1 kit.
This car, just like the Lotus Esprit, was fitted with a Garrett turbocharger, really packing air into the cylinders.
The uprated engine kicked out a whopping 200 horsepower. But with all that added power, the streamlined rear-wheel drive Sierra would struggle for grip on corners.
So, taking technology from the likes of Formula One, the RS was given a rather large, highly distinctive rear wing, known as the whale tail.
The iconic Ford Sierra RS Cosworth was complete. And to satisfy touring car rules, as well as the actual race cars, 5,000 road legal Cosies were built. It was, in essence, a racing car that you could go out and buy, then safely pootle about with your grandma. Although, to be honest, that wasn't really what most Cosie owners had in mind.
Lovely jubbly.
Where better to give it a good thrashing than back at Ford's technical center, on the very same track where Rod Mansfield's team put the RS through its paces in the early 80s.
It has to be said that it is a car that, if you give it some beans, it likes it. It sort of says, yes, give me more. Oh, yes.
Top speed had rocketed from around 100 to a staggering 150 miles an hour.
Ooh.
Supercar performance from a family car.
It's a great design, really.
On the racetrack, Ford dominated British touring cars, with a souped-up version, the RS500, winning an unbeaten 40 races back-to-back.
But it was the iconic road version that played such an important role in shaping the modern car. From the jelly mold, aerodynamically efficient shape, to excess power and racetrack handling, high-performance saloons have become the norm. So next time someone's tailgating you at 90 up the M6, I'm afraid you've got the Cosy to blame. For me, the Sierra RS Cosworth epitomises Britain in the 1980s. Bold, brash, in your face, and it was something new. It wasn't the most elegant of decades, but it was a fresh start. The teenage years of a more sophisticated, high-tech Britain. Our large-scale, homegrown industries may have been dying off, but thanks to new thinking, new ideas, and new technology, British engineering and design was alive and well. The future had landed. Here in Britain.